D-liquor surge tank. At this point, the solution is called D-liquor. It contains the vanadium, but not the uranium. The D-liquor from the surge tank is pumped to one of four SX feed conditioners. In these conditioners, we raise the pH of the solution with either ammonia or sometimes we use soda ash. It's necessary to raise the pH of the D-liquor and also to add sodium chlorate at this point. This changes the vanadium into a form that we can use to in our next step of the process, which is solvent extraction. In solvent extraction, we extract the vanadium away from the solution. This is done in our SX plant that you see here. In solvent extraction, the D-liquor solution, after it's adjusted, is mixed with an organic solution. This organic is a mixture of kerosene and amine. It has the ability to take the vanadium away from the aqueous solution. These are pictures of the kerosene and amine storage tanks. In the solvent extraction process, we have some 30,000 gallons of kerosene amine mixture. Of course, that's a very definite fire hazard. We're very strict about no smoking in this area and no lighted matches or flames. The amine and kerosene are stored in storage tanks. We receive it by tank truck. Howard, did you want to comment on the unloading procedure and the safety involved?
All trucks, when they come in with a load of chemical, have a definite printed unloading procedure. We also at this time have a hazard training program that each vendor, each truck driver has to be trained in unloading procedures before they are allowed to unload in our plant.
The kerosene and amine from the storage tanks are brought down into a small mixing tank where they're mixed and pumped into our lean organic storage tank, shown here. The lean organic is pumped to the solvent extraction circuit where it acts to take the vanadium away from the aqueous solution in the extraction portion of the circuit. We have six extraction mixer settlers and two strip mixer settlers. Once the vanadium is taken away from the aqueous solution, put into the organic solution, it's stripped away from that organic solution with a soda ash mixture. This process does the same essentially as ion exchange did for the uranium, in that it purifies and concentrates the vanadium, and you end up with a concentrated vanadium liquor in a soda ash solution. This is called our vanadium product liquor. This is a view of the soda ash storage tanks. As I mentioned before, soda ash is used to strip the vanadium away from the rich organic and to put it into a soda ash solution. This is another view of the soda ash storage tanks looking from the south. Once the vanadium is in solution, it's called vanadium product liquor. It's stored in this wooden tank and it's removed several times a day by tank truck and transported to our rifle plant. There it's converted into a vanadium oxide or various forms of vanadium oxide. Vanadium oxide is in turn used in the steel processes. In this picture we see the solvent extraction process control operator taking samples to determine how well the process is achieving the objectives.
The solvent extraction area is a maze of piping and handrail. One safety hazard in this area is some open holes that we have out over the settlers. You want to be sure that when you're working in this area, you watch out for the open holes.
In this picture, the operator is titrating a process control sample to determine the amount of vanadium at a particular stage in the process.
We have eyewash showers and safety showers located in the solvent extraction area. And again, it's important that you check these eyewash and safety showers out and know where they're located.
This is a view of the control panel for the solvent extraction process. The lights tell them which pumps are on, which mixers are on, rather. Here's a view of the fire extinguisher system. As I mentioned, Howard, we've got some 30,000 gallons of kerosene in this solvent extraction process, and it's a real fire hazard. And we have this elaborate fire control system.
What you mentioned is true, and fire is probably the greatest potential that we have in the whole plant is in the solvent extraction area with the kerosene and amine. Our fire protection system that we have is completely automatic. However, the operator must know how the system works and how it operates. There are certain portions of it where he might be called upon to turn a valve or open a pump. The area is completely covered with our light water automatic fire extinguisher system. Throughout the solvent extraction area, we have 30-pound dry chemical fire extinguishers also. They're located in just about every area of the solvent extraction area. It's the operator's responsibility to know where the fire extinguishers are located, that they're in good working condition, and that he is assured that he knows how to operate a fire extinguisher. Also, part of the operator's duties in this area is to be on a constant alert for fires and fire producing situations. One of the safety rules in our rules book in this area is no smoking or no open flames of any kind. If there is an occasion to do any cutting, welding, or use any open flames in this area, a fire permit must be obtained from your foreman.
I might say that firefighting is a real concern. We've never had a fire in the solvent extraction process, but we sure want to guard against it also. Here's a view of our solvent extraction waste product called raffinate. This raffinate is a low pH and has an organic content, so we're unable to discharge this to the river. We have three ways of disposing of raffinate. One is by evaporation ponds, as we have below town, in what's called our Club Ranch system. In this system we have six ponds. These ponds do not have outlets. We depend upon evaporation to remove the raffinate from the ponds. Another way we can dispose of raffinate is by pumping it to the top of the hill to an area called the Club Mesa area, where we spray the raffinate up into the air and depend upon the spray and the evaporation to dispose of raffinate.
One area of concern in the Club Ranch of the Club Mesa project, Bob, is open holes there. This is an old underground workings area, and there has been occasion where the ground has given in, and the individual working up in this area should be careful of open holes.
One thing with the raffinate, it is a slight hazard in that it can irritate your skin or eyes if it gets into your eyes. The third method we have of disposing of SX raffinate is by way of the neutralization circuit. In this circuit, we add a pulverized limestone slurry to the raffinate in a series of tanks. The limestone changes the acidity of the raffinate and causes a precipitate to form. The end result is a clear water that we are permitted to discharge to the river. This is a view of our river ponds. The river ponds are a system of ponds that receive certain process effluent, hillside runoff, and powerhouse drain water. This combined stream is continuously monitored and sampled, and we are permitted to discharge the outflow from these ponds to the river. All of our process water comes from the river, whereas all of our sanitary and drinking water comes from wells. This is a view of the canal which brings the mill water to the mill pumps. It's the beginning of our process water at this point. The water is pumped from the canal across this white pipe that you see there and into two of barge tanks that are called Clariflow tanks. These tanks serve the purpose of dropping the mud out of the water so that we have essentially clear water to start our process. Howard, up to this time we've talked quite a bit about the process, about operations. But as you know, over 50% of our employees are engaged in services and maintenance and other operations here.
Okay, to talk just a little bit about two of the services we have, Bob. We have an ambulance crew and we also have a fire department here in Yerevan. The fire department, I'll talk about it first, is what the state of Colorado calls a paid fire department. By this, we have operators who are assigned to the fire department, even though they regularly work as Plan 5 operator or an IX operator or something like this. They train, we have a training session every Tuesday to cover all four shifts. Now the ambulance is run by local EMTs. We have presently about 10 EMTs in Yerevan. The EMTs will take care of driving the ambulance and also as attendance if somebody should get injured. Fortunately, Bob, we've only used the ambulance once in the last 2.5 years, but we do have it just in case. Also in Yerevan, we have a resident doctor. He has a medics, and we also have two nurses on duty here at all times.
We have a new garage building where we service the plant vehicles and the heavy equipment for the plant.
We also have, Bob, several safety factors in all of our maintenance facilities. Probably the most important and least talked about aspect of safety is housekeeping. In any maintenance garage, shop, or otherwise, housekeeping is the first step to a good safety program. I think you can see in these pictures that we have fairly good housekeeping throughout our shop areas.
Here's a view of the carpenter shop.
Our carpenter shop has an excellent safety program.
That's right. There's a lot of potential for accidents here, and they've got an excellent safety record, and they're very well proud of it.
Here's a picture of the continuing accident performance of each employee in the carpenter shop. You can see that we have an excellent accident-free record for most of our employees in the carpenter shop. I believe this dates clear back to about 1969.
Here's a view of the instrument shop.
Union Carbide is also concerned about our employees off the job. Here we had an employee who had an off-the-job accident. He broke his little finger while he's playing basketball.
Right next to the instrument shop, there's the laboratory building. We run our process control samples here to determine the amount of vanadium and uranium in the circuit to help control the process. Also, they do a certain amount of sample bucking to prepare the samples that they send on down to Grand Junction.
We have a safety shower and eye wash in the lab, and it's important that people working in this area for any reason should know the location because of the chemicals and other hazards associated with the laboratory.
Here's a view of the new shop building. Most of the heavy maintenance is done at A plant. We also have a B plant shop building that does the smaller jobs and the jobs that are more located in B plant.
Again, Bob, I want to compliment the shop area's housekeeping as a first step to a good safety program. We have an excellent housekeeping program in just about all of our shops. We have fire extinguishers located throughout shop areas. Employees must know the location and how to use the fire extinguishers when working in our plant.
Here's a view of the receiving dock for the warehouse. I believe the warehouse crew has an excellent safety record as well, don't they, Howard?
Warehouse has an excellent safety record. But there are hazards associated with any warehouse. They have storage problems throughout the warehouse. They have a good housekeeping program, and they also have stairs and lighting problems to contend with, and they should be proud of their safety record.
This is a view of the powerhouse where we have four boilers to provide the steam necessary to heat many parts of the process. We also get our compressed air from the powerhouse and do the boiler feed water treatment at this point. We have an emergency generator facility, although most of the power we use comes from the outside.
There are some problems associated with powerhouse. Bob, there's a few lines, different types of chemicals in the powerhouse. They're all color-coded, and it's important to know the Urban piping color code. There's also a noise problem associated with the powerhouse in that the noise dBA level in the powerhouse runs approximately 85 decibels. It's not over the government guidelines, however, it is irritating and it can lead indirectly to accidents.
Yeah, although we don't have hazardous chemicals as such in the powerhouse, we do have hot water, steam, and hot pipes that could constitute a hazard. This is a view of the paint shop. Here's a view of the bee plant maintenance shop.
Bee plant maintenance have achieved an excellent safety record over the past 2 years, Bob. They've reduced the number of accidents in this area by about 60% over the last 2 years. The guys are working hard. Their housekeeping is better. Their work performance is better. They're following safe job procedures as well as they can now. And they're just doing an overall excellent job in the bee plant maintenance area.
And they've got a real challenge up there too, Howard, in that that's where they deal with the concentrated acid, the high temperature solutions. There's a lot of moving equipment, unguarded equipment, or potentially hazardous equipment, I should say. Here's a view of the main office building. And to the west of that, the new mining and geology building.
Here's a picture of our Urban clinic. We have a doctor on call 24 hours a day, as well as a nurse on call 24 hours a day. Hopefully, for industrial purpose, we never have to use our clinic facilities.
Of course, Urban is more than just a mill that produces uranium and vanadium. It's the homes and the church and the school, the buildings, the families, the people that make up the community. We have a lot of things to offer here. We've got some very fine recreation facilities.
Yes, Bob, we do. We've got plenty of good hunting in the San Juans and Uncle Padre Mountains. We've got good fishing in several lakes around the area. San Miguel River has good fishing in it. We have plenty of extra sporting events. We've got basketball, softball in the summertime. We have tennis courts. All in all, I think Urban sits in a very beautiful area at the end of the San Miguel River just before it flows into the Dolores River, Bob. I hope this tape has been informative. And again, we'd like to welcome you to Union Carbide in Urban.